When you get the sheet, it will show that we are on verse 9, okay, 9 through 14, and our study in John chapter 1 in relationship to the Christmas story. And so that is where we are in the class. It also says on the sheet at the very top, it says the word incarnate. So we are finally getting to the actual Christmas story, okay, in terms of this passage. So in verse 9 through 14 is where we find the actual incarnation. So we're going to begin studying that this morning. We will not finish studying that, however. Okay. In other words, it will take us longer to get through 9 through 14 because they're very involved verses. But I'm going to read 9 through 14 so we can start looking at it together. There was the true light, which coming into the world enlightens every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Recounting of Jesus' birth and the coming of Jesus presents two different ideas, as we mentioned there on that sheet. Okay, the two ideas is that the Word, which has been the main topic all the way up until this point, is the understanding of the pre-incarnate Christ and what all that meant, okay, the pre-incarnate Christ. And he was the Word. So he chooses a word that is familiar to the Jew and to the Greek, so that they would understand something new. From their background, they understood an awful lot of things, okay? But now he presents a new idea to them. And the new idea has to do with all that they think about the topic of the Logos and the Word being spoken by God in Genesis chapter 1. Okay? All that's a part of that is now going to find its way into a revelation that is flesh. It's going to come in a way that is completely unique and different than it's ever been spoken about or talked about or seen upon the face of the earth. And so this Word is now going to make itself revealed. Okay? And that is the real concept here. It is that revelation of the Godhead through the Word itself. And so that is the Christmas story. That is the meaning of the Christmas story. It has to do with this revelation. It is this presentation of this newness of that revelation to the men that are a part of the earth. Okay, so it's brand new, it's different, it's attached. These two huge words and concepts about what the Logos is and what the Word is, which we've already studied at great lengths, is now finding itself into the presence of man. And then, of course, the things that he attaches to it, the true light and the life, are now going to be participated in relationship to men themselves. And what you're going to find is that number two is that there is a choice. Because this revelation becomes flesh and becomes very well understood in its fullest term to humanity, okay, it's going to force a choice. Okay. And that's what you find that is going to be talked about in this particular passage that we are reading, verses 9 through 14. The coming of the Word into the flesh causes humanity to make a choice about God. Okay. They've already made these choices in the past, but now this revelation is so strong and so vital, it goes clear back to the very first prophecy. The seed will now be revealed. The seed was promised to Eve. And now that darkness that came upon humanity and upon Eve and Adam. Okay, from her loins will now come the seed that will be the revelation, okay, of all that God is and all that he is in terms of the concept of the word, all of life and all of light. Okay, and now man must make a choice. And so in reality, when you look at the incarnation, if you look at Luke and you look at other places in the Bible, there is a presentation of glory and majesty, okay, that from heaven they understand, okay, the coming of this child. Okay, but for us, in this particular gospel, it is the majesty of the word, which we have picked up all the way through, but it is to John, it is a choice that man must make now, because the revelation is made so clear and the life and the light have come so dramatically that man must now make a choice. Okay, either they're going to receive him and believe in him or they're not. So those are the two words he uses. Okay, they're going to either receive him and believe in him or they're not. And so to him, that is the dramatic meaning of the incarnation. It is the word becoming revealed, and that revelation, okay, that it puts on flesh to where man can really see it and understand it. What is the meaning of all that? The meaning is it is now so clear, so revealed in its truth and in its grace, okay, and from the very soul of God. It's so revealed to man. They are put in a position, okay, they're put in a position of choice. And they either receive it and believe it or they do not. And that's the main purpose of the coming of the Son. In other words, men now must choose. Okay, and so the child being here, this is the emphasis that you find from John. He's writing the last gospel. And he's picking up some ideas that the others do not really emphasize. And this presentation, it is the choice that essentially the revelation brings to humanity. So this, in this passage we're looking at from 9 through 14, this is actually one of the major emphases of the actual incarnation. Okay? And of course, the astonishing part is that men don't make the choice for him. So few do. That's the astonishing point. Okay? And that's what he emphasizes. He says he made the world, he came to the world, he was a part of the world, he came home to man, and they did not choose him. Okay? But to those who did choose him, these things are given to you. And so that's really what's going on in a kind of a summary statement as we look at this passage. Okay? So again, if you look at most presentations of the Christmas story, this choice is not a part of it. You never hear anything about the choice. Okay, it is completely a collection of ideas from the Word of God that had to do with the majesty of God revealing himself in the heavens. And then everybody coming and looking at the child, okay? But there's no sense of this choice. John is driving home that the coming of this child causes men to find themselves in the position of revelation. And because of that revelation, they are now forced to make a choice. Okay? And so that is what you see him emphasizing. So that's the difference between his gospel and the other gospels in terms of the incarnation, okay, as we go through that. Okay, so last week we talked about John the Baptist and why John the Baptist is mentioned, because during this time frame, John the Baptist was considered by many people to be the Messiah, even though John the Baptist claimed not to be the Messiah, and John wanted to make sure that these people understood that. Okay, so what was John? He was this voice, as he said, crying into the wilderness to prepare the way for God. Okay, and by using Isaiah chapter 40 to describe it, he helps define the word and also define the role of John the Baptist in that culture at that time. Okay, so that's what we looked at last time as to what was the purpose of John the Baptist in relationship to the word. And why put John the Baptist in the middle of this? And so these are some of the reasons that we looked at last time. If you would turn, I want to just show you, because this really clarifies this idea of the revelation causing man to make a choice. Okay, when John writes about John the Baptist again, okay, in his gospel, if you turn over to John chapter 3, verse 27. What you see is really kind of interesting, because John, the gospel writer, the apostle, he is referring to John the Baptist again. He has stopped talking about John the Baptist. He talked about him first in chapter 1 and the verses that we looked at last week. And then he talks about him again when Jesus first comes and John the Baptist claims, I'm not the Messiah, and there goes the Lamb of God. Okay, now he comes back to John the Baptist and uses an event that has to do with his disciples saying, we thought that you were the Messiah. What about this Jesus? Everybody's going to him. Okay, and yet you seem to be the chosen one of God. What's going on here? And then John the Baptist explains again. But what you have is an analysis or attack on, okay, of John the gospel writer explaining some things about it. And it goes right back to exactly where we are in this passage. We had John the Baptist, and then we had this statement that now he has come. And because of his coming, okay, everybody must make a decision about this revelation. So he really makes it clear in this passage. So let's look at John chapter 3, verse 27. And John answered and said, "A man can receive nothing unless it has been given him from heaven. You yourself bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. He who has the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. And so this joy of mine has been made full. He must increase and I must decrease." Notice verse 31. This is a commentary by John the writer, the apostle, on what John just said. So he's giving an event where John has spoken about God and Christ and himself. Okay, just like we had in the prologue, explaining who John was and what he was to do. And then John steps in verse 31 and gives his take of the whole thing, which he did in the prologue as well, which we're getting to. Okay, so this is what he said. "He who comes from above is above all. The Word is the true light." John is not the true light. The Word is the true light. Jesus is the true light. He who comes from above is the true light, not John the Baptist. Okay? And that's what he's trying to say. "He who is of the earth," John the Baptist, "is from the earth and speaks of the earth. He who comes from heaven is above all. What he has seen and heard, of that he bears witness, and no man receives his witness." This is exactly what he says in these verses. Jesus has come to give us the full revelation of what God is. He has come to tell you what the soul of God is, the bosom of the Father, the truth and the grace of the Father. He has come to give all that to man in its fullest context now. Okay? That's what he's explaining. What he has seen and what he has heard, he will bear witness. Jesus will bear witness to that. And what happens is that men don't respond. They don't receive it as a whole. He who does receive his message and his witness has set this seal to his life. Okay? That God is true. For he whom God has sent speaks the words of God, for he gives the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. He who believes in the Son has eternal life, but he who does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. John came as a forerunner, just like the prologue said. What did he come as a forerunner for? For the presentation of God to humanity, which we have just looked in verse 9 and 10 and 11 in chapter 1. And this is what he's saying again. See, he's making it clear again, exact same setup. Okay? And then he basically states that what has been given by the Father to you and me is life and light that will be eternally given to us if we accept that revelation, the Son that has become incarnate. And that choice is between all of us. All of us must make this choice. If we make the choice, we have life. If we don't make the choice, we will not have life. And that's how he ends that. And it is just a complete repeating of what he said in the prologue. Okay? And so it's very interesting what's on the mind of John when he is putting forth what the incarnation means. This is what the incarnation means. Okay? It is the choice because of the full revelation. Jesus brought everything that God had in his mind and his heart, okay, to man and grace and truth. And man must respond. Okay? And man's response has been pretty negative. That's what it says. Okay? But if it's not negative, you receive everything that you have ever wanted, eternal life. Okay, in terms of what it is. So he's making it very clear again as to what he sees the revelation and the incarnation of Christ to mean. Okay, so when you see the Christmas story this year, I hope that you think back over this passage and then the passage that we're looking at in 9, 10, and 11, and 12, okay, where the choice is being made because of the revelation, the incarnation. Okay, all right. So let's look back in chapter 1 and go through the words that he chooses to describe these issues. On the sheet that you have under A, the incarnation of the word, true light, the greatest dispeller of darkness, the moral condition of all men, has come into the world. That's the first reference to the incarnation. Okay? So this is, in verse 9, is the first time that John says he has been talking about the Word in its pre-incarnate form before it came. Okay? Now it has come. And he is now describing its coming and what it means. So until then, all he's been talking about is everything that Jesus was before he ever came. Okay, and summarizing as we've gone through all of that, what that means to us. Okay, now let me point out to you, there are two great religions in the world right now. The third one is Hinduism. The second one is Islam. The first is Christianity. So Christianity and Islam are the two great religions in the world. Hinduism is actually diminishing. Christianity is growing and Islam is growing. Islam is growing faster than Christianity at this point. The complete difference between these two faiths, okay, in terms of the person of Jesus, is one fact. The difference between the two faiths is that they look at Jesus. Jesus is the second highest prophet in the Islamic faith. They believe that he's the Messiah that was promised in the Old Testament. If you read the Quran, When I have my students read the Quran, I pull out portions of the Quran and let them read what it says about Jesus in the Quran. Okay, and it states categorically Jesus was the Messiah of the Old Testament. Okay, but the one thing that separates the two faiths is that they believe that Jesus is nothing but a great prophet sent by God to bring an ethical teaching to mankind so that you and I can do good works following the ethical teaching to be able to get to God. That is essentially the Islamic faith. Muhammad was sent to correct one idea, and the one idea is that Jesus is God. That is the one thing they do not believe in. And that is the one thing that separates Christianity from Islam. Okay? Jesus is not God. Okay? And this particular passage that you and I are studying is a definite description of everything and what the New Testament and all of our faith and all that God wanted us to understand about his son. Okay, that he is pre-incarnate. He is the word that composes all thoughts of man and all thoughts of God and all the soul of God. Okay, and they were an essence of one, and they were in the beginning, both of them. Okay, as well as the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. And this description that you got in the first 8 verses is completely aesthetical, completely against everything. It's an antithesis of Mohammedanism, of the Islamic faith. Okay, that is the separation. Okay, so it's something to remember when you think about what's the real difference between their faiths. There's a lot of differences, but this is one. For instance, they believe that Jesus was brought to the earth at this time of year. In other words, they believe that Jesus had a virgin birth. Okay, that Mary did not conceive this child from a man. She conceived this child from God. But this concept that she received this child was a miracle that was zapped in her womb. He did not overcome her. When Gabriel says, the Holy Spirit will overcome you, and that child will thus be the Son of God as well as the Son of Man. Now, that idea and that concept is very difficult to understand for us. But that's exactly what it states. Okay, and they say, oh, no, oh, no, oh, no. Okay. That is a totally erroneous idea. What God did was speak to Mary, and then he just said, you have a child inside your womb. Okay, and so her gestation period was not 9 months. It was within weeks. It was a miracle. She had full-term baby within a week. Okay, and when she gave birth to that baby literally spoke from the crib and said, I am not God. I mean, I have them read this in the Quran. It's in the Quran. Okay? And so this is the difference that you need to be aware of, okay, as to these two faiths. It hinges upon Jesus. They are a part of the group that is in this verse that says they don't believe this. Okay? They have chosen not to believe it. And the whole group has chosen not to believe it. Okay? And so that is the basic situation that you see between the two great faiths of the world. All right? So they reject it. It's astonishing that most men do not accept that God revealed himself through this child. Okay? You have any questions on that before we go on? Yeah.
So they have their own version of Jesus' life and teaching, which would exclude the fact that he said, I am.
That's right. That's right. They actually believe that the disciples misunderstood Jesus. Okay, and they called him divine, and he never called himself divine. And what you find in the Gospel of John is an over and over and over reassurance to us that he called himself divine. That he, as many writers have said, this prologue of 18 verses is the consciousness of what Jesus thought of himself. Okay? So they understood that's what he thought about himself. And he said it over and over and over and over again. I am the Word. Okay? So that's the complete mistake of the Islamic faith. And yet they can't take that. They will not take that. Okay? And that is the major issue. Now, what is the one way that you would basically handle, or there's two ways that you actually would handle the Islamic message in terms of which one's right and which one's wrong? What would you say? I mean, they would just, somebody would just look at it, well, you've got two opinions here. Which one's right and which one's wrong? I mean, you believe it, but they believe something else. Maybe they're right. Okay? So how, I mean, for my students, that's the question. Who's right if you've got the apologetic position? So what would you say?
Resurrection.
Actually, Jesus himself keys everything he said about himself as being the Son of God on the resurrection. The resurrection is the key apologetics, okay, the cornerstone of apologetics. In other words, which one's which right? Which one is which right? Okay, it is the resurrection. Okay. So the resurrection, if you prove the resurrection, because everything Paul says in Romans, his dissertation, okay, a theological dissertation, the first thing he says in the first three verses is, Jesus came through the prophecies of the Old Testament to demonstrate that he was the Messiah. He rose from the dead to show that he was the Son of God. So these are the two basic ideas.
How does Islam explain the resurrection?
They do not believe that he rose from the dead. In other words, they believe that he was translated and that somebody else died upon the cross. They think that Judas Iscariot died upon the cross, that an imposter died. It wasn't Jesus who died, that he was translated, taken by God.
They believe who died?
Hmm?
They believe who died?
Judas Iscariot.
Oh,
Jesus.
Yeah. Okay. So the resurrection becomes the key point. In other words, we can trace historically the death of Christ through all sorts of documents in terms of was he put into that tomb and was he not, what happened to him on that day. Not only the four Gospels, but we have Pilate's letter that describes all the events. We have Tacitus, we have Irenaeus, we have Josephus. We have all sorts of writers who tell us about the historical events of the Bible, of the New Testament. So these are men who saw the events or heard of the events within the time of Christ. Okay. Plus, thousands upon thousands of people, when they read the Gospels, they could verify it or not verify it. In other words, they lived during all this time. They could say, well, he died on the cross or he didn't die on the cross. They can say his tomb was right over there. Okay, and, you know, they buried him in that. They can say the tomb is empty. 1 month later, the tomb was empty. You stop Christianity dead in its tracks if you produce the body. That's exactly what Peter said in the first preaching. David's tomb's down here, and his body's down there, and everybody knows it's down there. You all know that he was crucified. You crucified him. That's what he says. And we put him in the tomb, and you go down there and look at that tomb. There isn't any body. Okay? And the perfect way for the Sanhedrin, the Council of the Jews, to stop Christianity dead in its tracks was to produce the body. Couldn't produce the body. So that's part of the proof of the resurrection. Okay? We're getting completely off the subject here. But yes. Well, they believe in the Quran, and the Quran actually addresses it and saying that he was just translated. But if you take it into history and into facts and to the different kinds of things that we understand, this is essentially where you find your belief. Okay. It's different than what the Quran is stating. And they have really nothing to believe in terms of, for instance, These are all eyewitness accounts that could have been all the head, all, when they wrote these four books, thousands upon thousands of people, and within those thousands of people, writers who could have stood up and said, I was there, and he didn't feed the 5,000. McDonald's did. Okay? I was one of the group. He didn't do that. Okay? I visited the tomb, and the tomb was not empty. Okay? There was a body in it. Well, the tomb's empty. Okay. I visited the tomb, and when I went into the tomb, all the clothing that surrounded the body of Christ was torn apart and shredded. It was inside the deal. The disciples stole the body and shred all the linens that were put on it. Okay. When you look at the word lying, okay, that is the word that's used in the Bible to describe the body of Christ. The word means that the linens were collapsed, intact, with no body on them. So everybody could walk into the tomb just like Peter and John did, and they went in and they said they saw the linens lying there and the head cloth over here. The linens were still in the tomb. Anybody could have gone in and seen those linens. And those linens were intact with no body inside of it. Now, how do you do that? If you're going to steal the body, the linens would be gone or ripped apart. There's all sorts. There's 2,000 years of attacks upon Christianity. 2,000 years of attacks on Christianity. Okay. I mean, the one key to Christianity is the resurrection. Just like Jesus said. They said, show me a sign in chapter 2 of John. Show me a sign. And he said, the sign that you will be given is that you destroy this body and in 3 days I'll raise it up. And they thought he was talking about the temple. And then John says, we all thought he was talking about the temple. But when he rose from the dead, we remember that he said this. This is the sign that he is exactly who he said he was. So the resurrection is the key. You take away the resurrection and everything falls apart.
About how many years later was the Quran?
500.
So was nobody present?
Nobody present. Islam was essentially Muhammad's, well, it is. It's a one book, one man thing. Okay. And so essentially he wrote that.
He wasn't there.
He wasn't there. And that's the whole point. Okay. In terms of eyewitness accounts versus somebody 500 years later telling us that the eyewitness accounts are not right.
Okay. But he copied just enough.
Hmm?
He copied just enough from what happened.
Yes, he did. But he was, his main, one of his main objectives was to show that the disciples had made a mistake and Allah had sent him to correct the mistake. Jesus was a prophet, the highest prophet up until that time. He was the Messiah. By the way, they do believe that he was the Messiah. They believe the Old Testament. The Old Testaments tell us that he would be the Son of God. The prophecies of the Old Testament tell us, and they do believe in the Old Testament. I don't have time to go through why they believe in all the Testament, but they do. So you can go back and show in Isaiah chapter 7 and Isaiah chapter 9 that Jesus was to be the Son of God, and they believe that. Okay. In other words, they believe those scriptures. They just don't read them. They don't ever read the Old Testament, but they believe in the Old Testament. Okay. So it's a place to start when you start talking to an Islamic person. Okay. If you're debating these issues. We haven't got anywhere into our lesson. Yeah, we have. We've gotten somewhere. But it was my fault for going off on this tangent. All right, the coming into the world. Okay. Barclay says, other lights were flickers of truth. Some were faint glimpses of reality. Some will of the wisps which men followed and which led men out into the dark and left them there. That's what Christ is, the light of real illumination to men. And then it says that Christ lights every man in this verse. It says that he lights every man. The word gives light only to those who believe in him. But there is a general revelation to all mankind. Okay, so the verses I gave you there are James 1:17 and Romans 1:20. Okay, and the point when it says he lights every man, that means that the lightness of what life really is, this is a moral concept, what is right and what is wrong. Okay, that light was given to all men, basically through their conscience. Okay, God made that for all men. Then he darkened it, man darkened it, and moved away from that moral right and wrong. Okay, so God has given all men light. Okay, in Romans 1, it says, they have no excuse because all of creation declares what God is and that he is there. And then what we find later on is that God comes and gives a particular light, a saving light, okay, through his son. And then there's the choice. Then men must make more of a choice in terms of the son. Okay. And so that's what this verse is talking about. It says, he came into the world, he gave light to all men. Okay, but they rejected that light that was even inside of them, telling them about who God was. Okay. All men. Okay. Men in all sorts of cultures have found God without having the word of God preached to them. Okay. The light was there for them to be able to be received. Okay, and but that the real light is through Jesus and this revelation of the incarnate word. Okay. And so that's essentially what he's trying to explain. Okay? Any questions on that? Well, let's go on. Yes?
Everybody has a conscience.
That's right.
Everybody knows right and wrong. A little baby knows right and wrong. And they know they've done something wrong.
They always choose, well, not always, but they choose an awful lot of wrong things.
Conscience continually. Yeah. Saying, oh, no, no, that's wrong. Yeah. Keeps telling me that all the time.
Yep. All right, number three, the significance of the repetition of the word world. It's actually repeated four times in two verses, three times in one verse. Okay, so let's take a look at that verse. He was in the world, and the world was made, verse 10. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. Okay, and so that's what it says. What John is trying to explain here is that there is a separation because of sin, because of the fall, of a world that was created by God, and yet there is a separation between God and man. Okay, and he is the one who's breaching the gap, not man. The incarnation is the breaching of the gap. Okay. So man is not making a move, okay, to get back to God. It is God who's making this move. Okay. And so the world is something he created, something that is his, something that he loves, and they are not making any move to him. He's making the move to him, to them. And so he comes. Okay. And that's what you see in this particular reference to the world. Okay. The Word was continuously in the world, and the world that he made, but the world did not know him. Okay. By the way, the word came, that particular word is in the aorist tense in the Greek, and what it means is it came at a certain moment in time. And so the light and the life and God himself came at that moment in time. Okay. And since that particular moment in time, it's now available at all times. Okay. So it's a moment in time that it came. So it's not like some ethereal idea that stretches throughout, you know, the beginning and the end. It actually came historically at an actual moment in time. Okay, and that's what the word came means. Okay, and that's what it's pointing it out. Okay, he came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. The word also came, also in its meaning, means he came home. Okay? He came to his own. He came to the people where his home was, where he had already established his home, and they rejected it. Okay? That's what the little verse down there it says in that particular deal. They didn't know him. And then it says he came to his own. God's chosen people, he came home, is a proper translation of that word. Okay? So there is a sense of coming to the Jew. Now, by the way, this is the Jew that is being, all of the world's there, it's got to make that decision. But now he says he came to the ones that he had prepared the way. He had set his home already in order in the Jewish nation. So they should know and understand, because his home was already set up and he chose to go there and then breach out to the Gentile. But when he came to the Jew, they didn't receive him. Okay. And so that's essentially what he's trying to say. Okay, yeah.
Is the full extent of that, I mean, it goes back to the line of Jacob and the King David. And
that's right.
Jacob and Mary.
That's right. Now, you have to understand that when he says, the minute he says to us, they did not receive him, then he goes, but. Okay, but there was a group that did. So you can't totally just say every Jew is gone, okay, because they didn't, any of them received him. He now qualifies it. And he says, as a group, they did not receive him. Okay, what he has set up as a home base, they didn't receive him. But there was a group that did. Okay. And then this is where the real difference comes. Those who didn't and those who did. Okay, and that's where you begin, that's what we saw in John chapter 3. Where he says they didn't receive him, okay, but these did, and this is what they have. Okay. Now, there's in this particular reference here, it says they knew him not, he came to his own, and then John says they received him. He uses two words, received and believe. Okay, received and believe. Those are the two words that he uses for a man accepting what Jesus actually has said to them that saves him and gives him light and life. Okay, and we don't have time to go into this. Okay, we will go into it when we come back. But at least we've got into the incarnation. And at least I've been able to show you one of the major differences of his bringing that story to us has to do with the choice. Okay. It seems to be the total emphasis of his story is that when Jesus came, there must be a choice from every man because he came. That light is so strong and so clear and so there, okay, that man, every man from that point on must make a choice. Okay, and that's what John was saying. If you don't, you find yourself in death. If you do, you find yourself in light and life. Okay, and that starts with the choice. Without you making the choice in believing and receiving, you don't get this. See, this is the choice. But there were some who did. Okay, believe in the revelation. And what did they do? They received it and they believed it. And what we will do is look at those two words and what those words mean. Okay? See you later.